As a transgender woman human rights defender, what do you need to stay safe?
A home.
And what's the biggest challenge that you face?
At one sex work client at night, I would have more time to protect other women. By the time I find clients, go to bookings and avoid arrests, I really don't have enough time to look after and protect my sisters. I fled home when I was a teenager. I was being abused by my family. And then I told them I was trans and I couldn't stay. It wasn't safe. So I ended up homeless and sleeping in a train station. I had no money, of course. And in order to eat, I started selling sex. And eventually, I found a place to live. I met Shinta, a transgender woman who founded this school, and came here. These are my people. This place is our home. Here in Yogyakarta, we work, but the police bother us, they assault us. I started speaking up and defending other sex workers who didn't know anything about their rights. But the police, knowing who I was, and they target me because of this. For years, I split my nights between earning money from sex work and working to make sure other sex workers live as well. I taught myself everything I know, health, human rights, and I learned by doing. I talked to the police, the doctors, nurses, and now, they call me. But I realized early on that doing this work just as innocent. Oh my god. Who would listen to just one trans woman? So we form a group. A group with a name. Because that is what officials will listen to. On the street at night, I cannot focus on anything except making money. Because I have to eat. But if I didn't have to focus completely on clients, you know, on making enough money to eat tomorrow, I would devote more time and brain space to protect other women.
Ines was assigned male at birth. Since the day she was away from home, Ines applied makeup and styled her hair, quote, like a girl. For her to pay more attention to her at night on the streets.
Police recognized me immediately among the trans women. They singled me out, abused me, they took my photo, they followed me. I'm in more danger than other sex workers because of my visible activism. And I'm definitely in more danger than not sex because when they go home at night, I go to the street. So I cut my hair short. I bought only men's clothes to wear during the day. But at night, I keep my real clothes, my beautiful and gorgeous dresses. Some of other trans me for, but what can I say? Hey, I survive. It's for my security.
Ines died of discrimination. She died because of the money she did not have. She died from the emergency phone call she made instead of making money. She died of the rallies she led and the dresses she did not wear and the makeup she washed off and put back on twice as many other sex workers. She died of homelessness and hunger and untreated, curable, preventable disease. Ines died from hundreds of intersecting forms of violence.
Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. Today is an incredibly important day for sex worker rights activists, for many of us in the community who've been doing this work for a long time. This is the launch of the findings of the Frontline Defenders four-year investigation into attacks on sex worker rights defenders. This is a long time coming for sex worker rights activists who have done this work around the world for decades. It has been, I think, over the last decade or so that kind of global human rights groups have started making the connections between the kinds of attacks they see on human rights defenders and sex worker defenders. You can see that in the video. The animation is the story of Ines, a sex worker rights defender who, in many ways, motivated this report. Researchers had met with her. They realized that the organization Frontline Defenders and others had learning to do to better support sex worker rights defenders who are at risk, and they embarked on this journey. Just on a personal note, when I was watching that story, I was thinking of a sex worker human rights defender, a trans rights defender, an immigrants rights defender here in where I am, named Lorena Borjas, who died last year of complications from COVID-19. And I first came across Lorena's work when she was helping to support trans Latinas in Queens, which is a predominantly immigrant community here in New York that was really hard hit by COVID. And she was doing things like support for folks at immigration detention, helping sex workers and trans women profile as sex workers get out of jail when they were arrested simply for walking down the street, literally for what they wore and where they were going. This kind of abuse that sex workers face, not just in their work, but also in their work to support one another as a community, whether it's from police or others, endemic, and this work could not be coming at a more important time while sex worker rights defenders are so around the world, not just from the systemic oppressions that have been with us, but also now in this very precarious moment with COVID. So I want to recognize Lorena Borjas, and I miss you, and I miss the work that you gave. Right now, we're going to grant the work that we're doing sort of in this larger global picture and talk about sex worker rights defenders' play in protecting human rights. And to kick us off, we are incredibly honored to have with us this morning Dr. Tlaleng Mofokeng. She's the UN Special Rapporteur on the Right to Health. It is so significant to have this kind of recognition from different than the UN. She is a renowned advocate for rights, and she's going to speak to us about the critical role that sex worker activists and sex worker rights defenders play in protecting and creating access to rights. We're so grateful that she's here. Thank you for spending time with us today and helping us mark this really important moment. I will hand it off to you now, Dr. T.
Thank you so much for this invitation to really this very important occasion. And many of you are my own colleagues as well as and really respectful of the work that you do on the ground every day, navigating really, really the right to health is interlinked with all other human rights, and these violations of the right to health, an indictment on human rights apparatus which claim to protect all people but still leave those in vulnerable situations behind, with the evidence that such neglect of sex workers and sex worker rights defenders leaves the work of defending human rights incomplete, and hence the commitments made by states to respect, fulfill, and protect human rights of all people still continue to ring hollow. And with this very important report today being the launch, it's an even clearer picture of the work that remains. And it is imperative that each and every story, every experience, and report of violation be illuminated in our quest for achieving full human rights for sex workers. Of course, being a special rapporteur on the right to health, my lens onto the issue of sex worker rights and sex worker rights defenders is through an intersection of the right to work and labor practice and health of sex workers. And I often like to frame it as occupational health and safety, because we know that the International Labour Organization has already recognized sex work as work. And there are different ways, of course, of using the special rapporteur and using the independent experts at the UN to either report ongoing or past or possible human rights violations. And there are various ways in which I undertake my work, such as to do fact finding, as well as, of course, communicating with member states concerned about those allegations of rights abuses. And of course, at this time of COVID-19, the travel restrictions have made it really difficult to do the work on the ground. But I remain encouraged by these types of gatherings and these very important moments to really continue to advocate, especially because we know when we are talking about human rights, we often reminded that all people are entitled to have their human rights protected, but we don't often stop to think about those who the system considers human. And if you're thinking about women, Black people, queer people, people with disabilities, people who are living in poverty or experiencing homelessness, people who are using drugs, are always left out of services and goods, and their human rights are often abused. And so we know that sex work exists at the very intersection that I've mentioned above, and from the primary lifeline that sustains them as well as their families. And despite this, sex workers remain the most abused society and constantly under siege and an incredible pressure from the general public as well as governments who project moralistic concerns aimed at controlling primarily sexuality. And in 2020, the Joint United Nations Program on HIV, which is UNAIDS, called upon countries to take immediate action grounded in human rights principles, particularly during the COVID-19 pandemic, to protect the health of and sex workers. However, as the report will show, both sex workers and those who defend their rights remain under attack. And I have my own personal experiences on that particular issue. In a report on deprivation of liberty and the right to health, the previous special rapporteur on the right to health also referred to restrictions on the liberty of movement that have appeared over the last 200 years as a tool of social control. And we know right now with COVID-19 and how many governments have responded in terms of limitations of movements and gatherings, we are concerned that some of those policies may remain long after the pandemic has left us. And often used as a default for public safety and public health, as if sex work and sex workers by default are in contradiction to public safety and public health. And that's special rapporteur also highlighted the existence of legal frameworks that lead to detention of individuals on the grounds of behaviors, identities, just labeled as immoral. And in many of us in the cities and the towns we live in, we know how bylaws are often implemented as, you know, targeted for loitering, especially those who work outdoors. And we know of morale intersect with sex work, sexual orientation, gender identity, drug use, HIV status, and other concerns. And now with COVID-19, we know in terms of transmission, how that has had a direct effect on the health of sex workers by their ability to be members of society who are economically active. The other important issue, of course, is one of incarceration that is linked to these types of behaviors and how that hinders the realization of the right to health. We also know how criminalization and incarceration and sustained solutions that eventually trickle down to affect everyone, but mostly those people who are living in the margins. the forms of punitive legislations are often a form of authoritarian government and social structures and organization, and those infringe on everyone's right to bodily autonomy, for example, to dignity, and women with disabilities. And so the protection of sex workers and sex worker rights and those who defend sex workers should be a concern to everyone. We can talk further about, you know, the different, you know, important work and the misconceptions. But, you know, I wrote a piece previously in Vogue where I was talking about, you know, even all sex workers engage in penetrative sex, right? That, of course, there's sex work that includes that, include companionship, include intimacy, include counsel, and sexual role playing, for that many sex workers take on multiple roles with their clients. And of course, some may get more physical. Others have started off as sexual and may evolve into more emotional and psychological bonding. And so who are the people who transcend sex workers? Another very important point that we need to discuss. And of course, the clients, they are not just men. And we know that the idea of purchasing intimacy and paying for services can be affirming for many people who need human connection, friendship, and emotional support. And of course, today with online spaces and applications, made these interactions and negotiations a bit safer for women sex workers, as opposed to outdoor in the streets where the threat of community and harassment remains. But governments opt the evidence for economic and social basis for sex work, even though the International Labour Organization estimates that sex workers support between 5 and 8 other people with their earnings, and that they do to the economy. Governments ignore the nuanced histories and the context in different countries, and thus continue to wrongfully offer blanket solutions and rescue models, which are rooted also very much in patriarchy and women. I just want to say that I know the impact of criminalization, being a South African myself, and being someone who has been advocating for decriminalization of sex work as a medical practitioner, and knowing, of course, that the majority of sex workers are cisgender women, are transgender women, and it means that sex worker rights are a feminist issue. And if you support women's rights, I urge you to support the demand for sex work protection of sex work right defenders, and find evidence and rights-based intersectional programs that are aimed at sex workers and their clients, and more broadly society, which continues to suffer and discrimination. And we must support efforts to address structural barriers that have been highlighted in the report, and ensure the implementation of not only comprehensive packages around health services, but other civic services as well. And I agree with decriminalization as the best legal model for human rights. And I draw on the work heavily of Sweat and Sisonge in Africa, and analyzation, all of the laws that govern sex work be removed, and that sex by labor law, because sex work is recognized as work. I want to also say that evidence and not morality should guide and sex work policy in general, and this should be for full sex work decriminalization. And we must use existing methods and institutions such as the United Nations and the various special rapporteurs to also submit complaints of rights violations that are ongoing or past or currently happening that do affect sex workers and the defenders. Right. Thank you very much.
I'm muted. I'm so sorry. I'll go back and say that very quickly so we won't take up too much of these remarks. And thank you so much for being here and kicking the day off.
how sex worker human rights work is fundamentally intersectional. We are taking this work from a place of protecting health, protecting labor, addressing criminalization and incarceration, and now sort of bringing this to the human rights defense space. And sex worker rights activists have always been working in a human rights framework. I think it's just now that we're sort of seeing recognition around the world. And to speak to that, and to speak to sort of how we got to this moment, bring in Erin Kilbride, the researcher who designed and led the investigative research trips, the collaboration with sex worker activists, to interview more than 100 and community members to produce this report, to tell us about how we got here, so important, and what the report and the work behind it might actually lead to. So thank you, Erin. Thanks for doing all this work and for taking it from here.
Sure thing. Can you hear me okay? I'm gonna wait for a note from the person in charge of this thing. Okay. Thank you, Melissa. And Dr. T, thank you so much for that. That was really wonderful, and I think particularly having perspective from the region that you are, there is just such an incredible history of sex worker rights activism. We were recently by one of the founders and former directors of the Africa Sex Worker Alliance, and already the impact that she has made here has been immense. So thank you so much. I am Erin. I use she, they pronouns. I do not identify as a sex worker. I think that's a really important place to start. There is a chronic lack of space for out sex workers in many professions. And unfortunately, the human rights field is not really much an exception. I do hope that this report is a small contribution to completely dismantling and completely destroying the stigma and the discrimination that keeps sex worker rights defenders marginalized from human rights spaces. That was one of our really key goals with this report, was to say from our small corner, we are very focused on the protection of human rights defenders. What is the impact that we could make on opening more doors, carving out more space for sex worker rights defenders who have access to protection services that they have earned through their human rights work. So I'm going to attempt to do this pretty quick. It's not what I'm known for, because I would much prefer that you hear from sex worker rights defenders themselves. Over the past 4 years, I've had the opportunity to speak to almost 400 now sex and their community members. And from day one, my colleagues and I have been struck by how fundamentally recognizable their work is as human rights work. Ines, who I apologize for the choppy video, but if you were able to hear any of it, Ines in Indonesia is the first sex worker rights defender that I knowingly met. We'll speak out a bit later. I'm sure that actually I had met many more and just not known. Ines was frequently even before she died of HIV-related complications. She was frequently targeted by police on the selling sex, but she was targeted by name because they recognized her from her human rights work. They recognized her from the marches that she led and the protests that she organized and the meetings that she advocated for, the hospital waiting rooms that she would not leave until her friends were given the care that they needed, the housing policy offices that she would organize sit-ins outside of because her friends deserved housing. And they recognized her for that, and that's why they targeted her, used her vulnerability as a sex worker as a way to target her. She defended others and was harassed and abused because of that work. And that is the truth that my colleagues and I kept coming back to again and again, case after case, when the complexities of this topic overwhelmed us. And I think they overwhelmed us maybe in different times and in different ways, but each of us has been overwhelmed. Especially when the human rights work that defenders were doing, they were doing in spaces that we did not have experience conducting research in.
We did not have experience analyzing human rights work in brothels, for example, or in of the sex trade. But as long as we continue to come back to the fact that they were doing human rights work, defending the rights of others, and demonstrably targeted because of that work, it became very clear that this falls directly within our mandate, and that's why we're here. The risks that these defenders face, that we learned about in 20 different countries in the past few years, are human rights defenders have told us stories of arrest, of sexual assault in detention, of extreme financial burden, having to choose between taking a client at night, for example, or responding to an emergency attack, full attacks and police surveillance while doing community outreach. This is something that Katie told you about later. Locate the areas in which they sell sex from the areas in which they are an activist, which again puts those two identities in conflict. Public defamation campaigns, and as we were saying earlier, policy making spaces in which they have clear and unmatched expertise. It is really important to note, because this is a common question that we get, that the work of sex workers, of those who identify as sex worker rights defenders, because we take our language from them, it benefits not only others, who benefits those who were forced or coerced or otherwise do not want to be in the sex trade. Human rights defenders who are sex workers themselves are the best and sometimes only activists and community workers who are qualified and capable to access, to negotiate their way to some of the most dangerous locations where sex is sold. And yet, despite that work, very clearly human rights work, as Ismail will soon tell you, when many of these activists are arrested, sexually assaulted, or threatened, there is a widespread and sort of derogatory assumption that the risks that they face are just because they're a sex worker. We heard this phrase a lot through many translators in the US. We heard that phrase a lot. They think it's just because I'm a sex worker. And yet we gathered evidence that a vast number of attacks on these defenders are directly tied to their work. And this evidence includes singled out by name on the street and having references made to their organizations, having police call them, pretending them to stop their human rights work. It includes sex work clients who were formerly quite peaceful, never caught becoming violent with sex worker rights defenders, only when they learn about their activism. What we were trying to demonstrate with this report is that at the intersection of these identities, there is immense power, but there's also immense risk. And as a result, these defenders need, deserve, and have earned access to human rights spaces and to human rights defender protection mechanisms. I am immensely grateful and probably forever astounded by the bravery of defenders who told us their stories and risked re-traumatization in doing so. The defenders who brought a non-sex worker into their spaces in order to meet their communities, and as well by the compassionate expertise and the personal risks by the translators and activists who coordinated and co-led the investigative research trips with us. This work would absolutely not have been possible without Yasmin Omari in Tanzania, without Aizat Chakieva in Kyrgyzstan, Radul Limu in El Salvador, and an activist in Myanmar whose name has been withheld for security given the events there. And I am, of course, immensely grateful for the faith and the impressively unwavering support of Andrew Adam, of Medin, and of many other FLD colleagues, the feminist partners from the WHRD, the Women Human Rights Defender International Coalition. Solidarity was hugely, and mostly to the sex worker organizations who guided us through this work. So I will leave it there. I really look forward to hearing from all of you how we can use this report to continue to advance the work that sex workers are doing in their own communities. And our connection holds up long enough for you to hear from some defenders.
Great, thank you so much, Erin. And I hope everyone can hear me now too. Let's hear a bit more from folks at Frontline Defenders about this report, how it came to be, how this sort of fits the work that they're doing. Next is Andrew Anderson, the executive director. And he's going to talk about how the organization embarked on this process, which still within some human rights spaces would be considered pretty controversial, to center the expertise of sex workers, to sort of step outside of some of the political debates around sex work and really focus on the impact on sex workers of criminalization, of human rights violations. So he's going to talk a bit more about what they've learned and also how they've grown as organization in doing this work. So thank you, Andrew. I'll pass it off to you.
Thanks, Melissa. Sex workers' rights defenders protect their community's right to live free from discrimination, to access healthcare, housing, justice, and employment, and to organize. Sex workers' rights defenders are human rights defenders. They're arrested, attacked, sexually assaulted, detained, delegitimized, and defamed for their peaceful, legitimate human rights work. This report began as a process of learning and review to see how we could be more effective in providing support to human rights defenders working in context. Major lesson, as Erin said, was that we already knew more sex workers defenders than we thought we did. Many defenders already in our networks were cautious about how they themselves have the trust in us to talk with us about the full context of the risks that they faced. That process of learning has enabled us to integrate support to sex workers defenders, our capacity building, advocacy, digital protection, and grant making. And it is able to work with other at-risk defenders. It's important to acknowledge that there are many people who believe that the term sex work denies the human rights violations perpetrated involved in trafficking and the coerced exploitation of vulnerable people. Frontline Defenders is strongly opposed to trafficking and coercion. However, we also recognize that sex worker is not just terminology for moral or legal debate. It has been adopted by communities who are amongst the most defamed and stigmatized. Our approach to our work is to respect the language and identities used by the human rights defenders. This type of solidarity is particularly important for defenders who frequently spoken about further their stigmatization and the denial of their rights. There are many powerful testimonies in this report, but I want to highlight one. Method Bujiku, human rights defender and founding member of the organization TASEFO in Mwanza, Tanzania. TASEFO is a sex worker, an LGBT-led organization which fights for access to healthcare for marginalized populations, provides harm reduction, education and counseling services, and responds to emails from LGBTIQ plus people and sex workers detained and often abused by police. In the event of detentions or attacks against sex workers and LGBTIQ plus people, Method creates the communication chain among colleagues, collects money for bail bonds, and reviews current contacts inside the police force. He also coordinates contact with the few lawyers in Mwanza who are at least occasionally available to respond to violations against sex workers and LGBTIQ plus people. In 2015, Method and fellow TASEFO founders began planning to formally register the organization and move meetings out of the international NGO offices which hosted them. During one meeting in 2015, in which approximately 20 organizers were discussing the formation of TAFESA, 17 officers raided the restaurant and accused the defenders of teaching each other new sexual tricks and promoting prostitution. Police shouted, "Do you think people are free in this country?" While arresting the group, them to the police station where they demanded financial bribes and sex in exchange for potential release. All of the defenders who were detained were also sexually assaulted, beaten, and verbally abused by police officers. Several were repeatedly sexually assaulted in detention. Method was held for 3 weeks before being released on bail. And yet, Method and his fellow human rights defenders continue to do their work. They continue to try and help the most vulnerable. They continue to advocate for human rights. I hope that this report and the campaigning around it makes a difference for Method Bojiko and his colleagues. It's important for me to thank him and the hundreds of sex workers' rights defenders who trusted us and helped us to learn. I want to also thank my many colleagues who have also helped, and in particular to the brilliant Erin Kilbride, who built the relationships, led the research, focused through many challenges on how we as a human rights defender protection can most effectively support some of the most at-risk human rights defenders across the world. Sex workers' rights defenders are at risk because they are defending the basic human rights of communities amongst the most marginalized in every society. And that means they must be an integral part of our work at Frontline Defenders. Thank you. And thank you to all the participants in this discussion. Looking forward to hearing more.
Thank you so much. And also thank you again, Erin. You know, I feel like this is still an analysis that we can't take for granted, that sex worker, human rights defenders experience harassment, abuse, police violence, violence within their own communities that isn't necessarily and can certainly not be excused because they are doing sex work, that this comes with being a sex worker. That very often what it is sex workers' own visibility, sex workers providing care and support to their community that the broader community has excluded them from or is seeking to block them from. It's when sex workers find their public voice and take up public space that workers are at risk. And this is the moment, I think, to sort of become very clear about that and to become clear about whatever emotions, feelings, responses people might have to what sex work is or what sex work means. We as a community and sex workers around the world as a community need support for the work that they are doing to protect their own communities when very often few other people are doing that. It's always been sex workers who have stood up for one another, and seeing this kind of recognition and support from human rights defenders is really critical. And if you are listening and watch, help amplify that work and to further support the rights of sex workers. You have a lot to digest further from the rest of our program. We're going to start transitioning into hearing from sex worker human rights defenders themselves about the work that they're doing, about the work they've done as part of this research. First, we're going to go to the legendary Ceyenne Doroshow, who is with the organization GLITS, which she co-founded. She's going to speak about protecting her community and associated with gender activists in the US today. She's a longtime sex worker rights activist. So happy to have her here with us today. So Cheyenne, I'm kicking it over to you. Cheyenne, I think you're still on mute, if you can unmute. Thank you. We still can't hear you, unfortunately. Cheyenne, can you unmute yourself on your side? I'm sorry if you can't hear me too. We're going to sort out audio on Cheyenne's side. We're actually going to come back to her in just a minute. Right now, we're going to hear from Katie Min with the Asia Pacific Network of Sex. Just an incredible group doing work for across APNSW. It was probably more than 10 years ago in the first sort of global human rights conference I was part of around sex rights. Incredible honor to have you here today, especially given the work that you're doing, where you're doing it. So right now, we'd love to have you speak about the work of sex worker human rights defenders in your region and the threats of surveillance and arrest that you're all facing for doing that work in this moment.
Thank you. My name is Kitty, and I'm working for the Asia Pacific Network of Sex Worker as a regional coordinator. And I was born and grew up in Myanmar. And this is the good to talk about human rights defender in Myanmar. And as you all know, the current political situation of the Myanmar, and then also the human rights violation. However, I'm going to talk about the sex worker right defender facing the problem and to the for the February 2021. So the human right the violation is one of the primary issues they're facing sex worker everywhere in the Asian Pacific. Also, the human right violation and issue may take a different form, which is sex worker often face the physical violence, sexual, emotional, and mental violence. Perpetrator may include the police and military and also the administrative authority and also sometimes intimate partner and family member and also the society involved. Violence against sex worker can be happen in the workplace as well, in the home or the public space or contact is the legal rape on the sex worker venue often, and then the sex worker right defender may also face the violence from the neighborhood or followed and investigated by the police and another authority. The primarily organization like the example the religion group and also so-called rescue organization that. And sex worker rights defender and then that they appear face the many challenges, including the human rights violation and lack of social support, stigma and discrimination. Hard to fight the case there and access to the justice, especially when it was done by the police and local authority. All of these factors often lead perpetrator is believed that the perpetrator believes that they can attack sex worker and who work for the sex worker because of there is the no investigation or punishment of the violence again related with the sex worker. Of the sex worker often go uninvestigated and is some case and reported. Often sex worker right defender face the threatening and also they're followed by the police and also the perpetrator and their relative. So then their relative. And then also the another most important reason of human rights violation is criminalized of the sex worker in Asia and Pacific. There are 37 countries. Only one country, New Zealand, is the decriminalization of sex work, and the same state of the Australia is decriminalized. In all other countries, sex work is somehow criminalized, and this criminalized the flow to the human rights violation and issue against sex worker and their defender. Then human rights violation is common and higher than the many countries in the Southeast. The main reason is there is no practice of the human right. There's no initiated to promote and protect the human right of the citizen. It's including the sex worker and also the woman, which in the police see or use the sex worker as their ATM. You know, when they arrest, they need the money and they arrest to the sex worker and they ask for the money, which is always use the bribe. Online defending did the local organization did the research in the partnership with the local organization to bring the loss of example of the human rights violation. The consequence is the where the violence happened. The involvement of sex worker with the program became less. Because of the sex worker feel insecure and they avoid their social life, and also they began isolated with the sex worker and also the other people. And then also it in Myanmar, fear of arrest or other form of the right violation that devised the sex worker to go to underground harder to negotiate and also the consistent use of condom. And arrest make it hard to for the sex worker to access health services and also the access to justice, and also the isolated from their family, their peers, and also their friends. So people to identify where sex worker are get. It is also hard for organization and program to identify the hard that become very harder because the sex worker are hiding. So where they are gather, where they meet, it is because of the insecure workplace. And then also where the sex worker feel that they can experience the violence, they don't attend such a service of the avoid violence. As a result, the utilizing of those services seem to be useless and useful. Human rights violation, sex worker movement for their right, mobilization of the sex worker and collective action against sex violation becoming difficult for the sex worker to take part of it. Finally, I want to say the importance of the sex worker with the information about their right and legal literacy, capacity building, and collective action are necessary initiative for empower to the sex worker community and community-based defending the sex worker right. And then prevent to respond to the human rights violation by the sex worker and also the defender with the support of many partner. And I want to say that also the for have to take the state have to take the responsible of the protect and the right of their citizen in any country, including the women in rural area. Sexual kinds of violence should be protected by the state. That's I want to recommend this. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Kate. So now, sorry, I'm just catching up with our order of events and speakers. You know, it's COVID, so we're working through the best that we can. Right now, we're going to go back to Doroshow to hear a bit about the work that she's doing in the US and what Black transgender activists are facing. Particularly around sex work and human rights work. Ceyenne, do we have you? Can you just say hi to make sure that we can hear you? Okay, we will come back to Ceyenne in a sec. Now I think we're going to try Wenty Ismail from Tanzania. Wenty is working in an incredibly dangerous context in Tanzania. We're very, very lucky to have him today, leading emergency response work. He's turning his own home into a community center for sex workers. He's going to speak about the unique sex workers are facing at that moment when they become visible advocates for human rights. And we go to that video now.
My name is Wenty, and I'm an activist from Tanzania for both sex and LGBT rights. So basically, prostitution in Tanzania is illegal. And many women and young girls and even boys are forced into prostitution in opportunities, culture, and somehow disintegration in the family units, which I think are the in other countries for many of the women and girls and even boys to run into. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how sex workers sometimes are attacked because they are sex workers' rights defenders, and then it is somehow difficult for many people to actually relate that the sex workers are being attacked or are being discriminated or are being facing stigma. It is because of their human rights work and not entirely there because of the sex work. So a lot of people, including myself, have been through that. I find that sometimes when you meet the clients, they start to talk about like, we know you, we have seen you maybe in the news, or we have seen you in several platforms talking about sexy working, and we see that people are actually now aware of their rights, especially when it comes to the police. And some clients, they don't like you. Sometimes they will attack you, or sometimes they will even put you through troubles because they know that you're sending for other sexy workers who might in other ways or not be able to for their rights or for their space in the society. And then again, even the gay sex workers, sometimes they also not only sometimes but many times you find that when they meet people and then they are being attacked, it's not entirely because they are gay, but it's because sometimes when you meet the clients and you know through the conversation, because sometimes as a sex worker, sometimes when you meet clients, there is that conversation, and sometimes it's even after the sex. And when you talk to clients about what you do for other sex workers, you find that you are you're actually being attacked. Some of the of the forces like the police, they also don't like the sex workers defenders because the defenders are the ones who are actually bailing out the sex workers, are the ones who are actually telling the sex workers if the police will arrest you, don't give them money. So you see, they are actually focusing on those on their leaders, or they are if we attack them, then backup will not have the opportunity to actually seek for information or to actually seek for their rights, which is very important. So this is a great opportunity now for other people to actually see sex workers actually being attacked, not because they're sex workers, but because of what they're actually doing, because of what they're actually doing for other people in this world. And if we don't look closely, sometimes we may jump in that they are being attacked, it's because of the sex work. But entirely, when you make a follow-up question, when you have discussion with sex workers and actually look into their stories, we'll realize that a lot of sex workers' defenders are being attacked, not entirely because of sex work, it's because they don't like fighting sex workers in Tanzania. So that's all I can share for today. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was incredible to get to hear some of that story. For folks who may not have been able to hear, video that we showed earlier from Ines. You can actually go right now, or once we're done, to the front line. Wait till we're done, actually. We have a little bit more. To go to the Defenders YouTube channel, frontlinedefenders.org, to watch the videos that we've shown today, and also to hear more stories from sex worker rights defending the report. So last now, we have Kayandor Show again. We're going to over your channel. Yes, hello, we see you. How are you, Kayan? Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Yes, okay. All right, officially I'm passing the mic to you. Thank you, Kayan.
Hi, I'm Kayandor Show. I am probably the most famous Black New York City sex worker advocate. And now owning a housing unit for community, building a health clinic along with housing in New York City. Also, I'm the person that bailed people out of jail when COVID first started. This work doesn't come easy. It's very hard. You can go ahead. I'm actually getting my blood taken. Okay. So I'm at the doctor's office. So good. But this work doesn't come easy. I was the person that got Raina Boraz's body picked up when she died. As a sex worker, it is our job to be first responders in so many ways that society doesn't see. Doing this work is life-saving because we can save people. But at that same time, we are criminalized for the work we do, who we are, and we do as people. I wasn't a sex worker because I wanted to be a sex worker. I was a sex worker because I wanted to survive. And survival means by any means necessary. And I definitely stand for that. With work, I was able to take care of community and take my sex work to advocacy and policy where it needs to go. What does decriminalization mean for me? It definitely does not mean the Nordic model. The Nordic model for a city like mine is horrible. Decriminalization should, actually the word should come from us. As a sex worker, these very things should be discussed and put to the table by a sex worker. Not lawyers that don't have the voice to say these things. Sure, but I think I just did it. You know, as a sex worker, I've seen us as advocates take the force of community, society, and the politics around it. It's I have been judged by many of my own peers because I've just not recognized with people I find problematic. Because problematic people, I'm sorry, they're part of this community. We have to learn how to work together as organizers. Organizers have a sense of confidence. And as we well know, in this community, in this of work, are often trying to promote themselves and not thinking about community. This does not work. My agency, Gays and Lesbians Living in a Transgender Society, is about it's about building community from the inside out. It's about healing. It's about housing. This is about decriminalization. If we're going to do all these things, we need to give people sustainability. And sustainability means changing the laws. Right now, we need a state of emergency for Black trans women just to live. And we don't have that. We're writing policies about the dumbest shit on earth when a Black trans woman is dying every week. And we're not talking one, we're talking two, three, four, and five. These are the laws that we need sex workers to be able to work and not be criminalized or murdered. And I need you in your hometowns, in your countries, to understand that it's hard everywhere. Yeah, I come from a state of privilege, but as a Black trans woman, that is often not seen because a Black trans woman is last on a all accessible for most people. I don't know what else to say, but be encouraged, inspire yourselves to be the best host you can be, to step up and step out for community, because that's what we do.
Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us all. Oh, yeah, sorry, go ahead. Are you, keep going.
Okay, I'm going to have it, Nick, on Saturday at Forest Park, totally for free. Yoga, healing, meditation, a show, the COVID vaccine thing, and it's all for free. Confession show, and we're giving clothes out as well as food. It's all for community and it's all free. This is how community.
Great. I think with that, we have come to sort of our formal program with speakers. There's one thing though that we want to tell you about, which is that Margaret Cho, a performer, comedian, sex worker activist, she has recorded a video to sort of show her solidarity with all of us who are part of this report with this community. She really wanted to be here with us today, which is actually filming a new movie. So congratulations. And if folks want to see Margaret's message, or any of the other videos that we showed today, you can go to the Frontline Defenders YouTube channel and share them with folks after we've wrapped up. Right now, I think we have some time for people who've already dropped some questions into the chat boxes on whichever platform you might be watching this on. Just bear with us one moment. We'll see if we have any questions or ask a question and we will get to it. Okay, so I would love to ask this question of Katie, if you're still with us. One of the things that I think you mentioned that I would love to hear a little bit more about, and everyone mentioned this, but I think this might be one really good example, is how the work that sex workers have done to protect their health, like in terms of sharing condoms in the community, has been criminalized. And that for me, I think, was the first time that I understood that we weren't just being criminalized for being sex workers, we were being criminalized for things we were doing to try to care for ourselves. And that sort of what opened up for me thinking about, like, okay, well, that's what we're being punished for. We're being punished for trying to survive. And bringing that framework into thinking about things like pushing back on, you know, back on all these other things that harm us, pushing back on the police, that's the point at which we can experience violence too, because we're trying to say, no, we have a right to survive. You can't deny us that right to survive. But I know that APMSW has been in that particular fight of trying to both decriminalize and open up access as organizers, as human rights defenders. So I'm wondering if you could share a bit more about that.
Many of the works we started, even the peer worker, peer outreach worker, who are also from the community member, they also get arrested by the police. And then the organization have to go to police station and also make sure that, and they, we have to prove it, many of them, you know, that they are the part of the organization and they are doing for the HIV prevention. And also all the peer workers, and they have the enough equipment of the health education and etc. It's a weekend, and also that they had etc. So then they finally they released from the police station. However, and consistently, we have to do the advocacy with the police and local authority. And these people are doing for the HIV prevention with the organization. And also on the other hand, is the So they had the, I mean, the, I don't want to say right now the current situation, because we can't say anything is this, which one is the black or white. So the previously also there, however, we have that they had the two ministry that, Ministry of Health and Ministry of Home Affairs. The between the two ministry have also the lack of collaboration and lack of understanding. Why I'm saying that it happened in many countries, not only in the Myanmar. So Ministry of Condo and Ministry of Foreign Home Affairs arresting the sex worker are keeping the condo after to do the sex work. So in that case, and there also they increase the violence and also increase the right the police are asking to the sex worker. In that case, the if the state protect and and also the decriminalization of sex work. Why did not state think that when they come to when they only target to the sex worker? There have many people are doing the crime, and they are doing many things. But why they don't target or they don't follow to those people? And why only to the sex worker? Because of the society. Society does not support to the sex worker and people who are working for the sex worker. I can tell you that one of the examples that our member, ABNSW member, who are the part, the sex worker organization, they are part of violence against sex worker. And they had a lawyer. When their lawyer go to the to find the case, other lawyer also discriminate to her. And they stigmatize that she is the sex worker lawyer. So in that case, you know, it's the right, the funnel or the everyone can face the problem because of the law and policy does not support to the sex worker. Agent for the decrim sex work and recognition of sex work as the work, and that will make the reducing stigma and reducing HIV and also the reducing the violence. People do not know that is linked to HIV. They forget that because they see separately. Actually, they had the big linkage between their violence and HIV. People are trying to do about the prevent about HIV, but they did not link about their violence. One of the big factor for the HIV also. That's, I think, that's before I can tell you that.
Great. Thank you for that. And yeah, we've talked about a little bit, worth just underlining again that there's such an overlap here, whether we're talking about police, whether we're talking about health, whether we're talking about violence. These things are inseparable for sex workers. And so something that might look like, you know, a public health issue, like access to condoms, is a human rights issue. When that's criminalized, people's health is impacted, but also when sex workers try to protect our own communities and then are criminalized for that, that is a human rights issue as well. So it's hard to pull these things apart because they're impossible to pull apart. We experience them all time. But sometimes I think the way that especially big NGOs are organized, these things get siloed off from one another. Looking at this through the lens of human rights, like this report does, like these researchers and activists do, help to kind of bring it all together again and keep it from being separate. We just have two quick comments I want to read, and then please feel free to keep asking questions. We have a few more questions to wait. Offers criminalization is making sex workers' rights defenders vulnerable. It's about time for the rights in the top vote. And someone else adds, so many amazing sex worker rights activists, they should all be given medals and enough with the attacks, criminalization, and defamation. So one more thing, if you would like to read more about the report or share some news about the report with others, The Guardian has a big story today about and you can find that on The Guardian's news site. One question we have, let's see, Catherine Neal, and she wants to ask if people could share about the advocacy or support that they experience. That can be a question, Katie or Cayenne, if you want to jump in and respond to that. I don't know if we still have this now, but you're welcome.
question again? Hello.
So the question is, what kinds of support do you have from the community?
Okay, you were fading in and out that time.
Question is, support from faith communities that sex work have had. And also, Katie, you could jump in too.
What kind of support does the community give?
Or get faith community?
Oh, we do everything. We do everything from referrals to healing, justice. It's whatever, as an organizer and as a sex working thing community, it is not only my lead but my charge to try to help people with at their needs. So when someone requests relocation, we try to do that. When someone requests help with their family members, we try to do that. But most of the requests we get in this community is justice, because organizing is very hard. And a lot of organizers get out. So they need help going back to actually get some healing with doing this work. But we try to get this community money. Every day there's a crisis and someone needs to answer it. Thank God I'm answering. With my staff, so it ain't just me. It's a staff of five.
And Katie, were you gonna jump in? The question was about support or advocacy from faith communities for sex worker rights defenders.
I think for the sex, as myself and also the working for the sex worker organization, what are the needs of the sex worker? And I will literally bring off the working with the doula also. The sexual, as the organization, sex worker organization, we have to prioritize and we have to educate to the other people that who are not fully understand or fully knowing about the sex worker issue. It's like I see that many of the for the feminists, some of the feminist organization, and they feel that they are against to the sex worker. But actually, real feminists, we need to see the sex worker are also the part of the feminist and how we can work together. So in that case, the advocate and also then mobilize to the within community and also the outside of community and then the stakeholder. So they have the multi level or the advocacy. Many times we talk about the advocacy, we always see the state, but also we have to do to the our community member that to understand that they are right and then what is the law is impact to them and impact to their life and their family in the, their country level. So these are the made the capability of the community and understanding of their right to that can make themselves to be the defense. If it is a national law or national policy, it is hard to protect that. And also for the organization and the funder to have to support them. Because this is the defining to the human rights, the community themselves has to be the best to participate in. Only organization or the definer people cannot do it. That self have to be the defined themselves. So in that case, we had the multi-level or the advocacy, including to the community, to the state. Yes, thank you.
Thank you so much for that. We have a question now for Dr. T, if we have you, Dr. T. This is a question about what can we do more or better to make use of UN special procedures to support sex worker rights defenders? From Nadia, thank you. And I will hand it over to you, Dr. T.
Thank you so much. I think it's really important because being a bureaucratic space, made up of members, all the other human rights and treaty bodies, it is important to follow steps. For example, when one wants to submit communication to the special rapporteur, past violations ongoing concerning bills and legislation, as well as policies, but also as well as practices, because in some countries, the legislation and the policies are affirming of sex worker rights, practice of rights abusers. And so, I can drop it in the chat for people to share. On the HRDs website, there is an online form that people can use to submit any of the allegations and to be clear in terms of what the request is. And so the particular expert will then take steps in terms of investigation, as well as doing a country visit and mission to try bring justice and some remedy to the people who are involved. Is that and this is true for those NGOs that have funding involved in UN processes in terms of upcoming resolutions, in terms of different country reviews, peer reviews. For example, in my own mandate, when I was drawing up my General Assembly report that will be released in a few weeks, I did a call out for contributions, which was an open call, and we received about 66 NGOs that contributed, and some member states as well. And the theme there was looking at the impact of COVID-19 on sexual and reproductive health rights. So it's important to also keep up to date with the kind of reports that we also produce as independent experts, and use some of those in terms of advocating on a global, regional, and national level. For example, in my report for the General Assembly last year, as well as the Human Rights Council this year, I do speak about coloniality and patriarchy, and how all of those intersect to elicit certain outcomes, and how sex work, right, is at that intersection. So it's about also using the reports that we produce to advocate. Where you've invited me to come and share my ideas and show my support, which is something really important in the midst of global pushback, right, on anti-gender, anti-critical race theory, anti-intersectionality, that we actually should not be silenced. And I think this is one moment in time of advocacy, of amplifying each other's work and voices. And I think, especially with the UN, there is a bureaucracy and sometimes a sense that things move very slowly. But it's really just about, the longevity that this work requires, which is why I often speak about funding and resourcing of advocacy institutions, but also individual human rights defenders, and in this case, sex worker rights defenders. Thank you.
Thank you for that. And stick around, because we may have another question for you too. So I think this is a good one for anybody. This is from Coco Castellas. What are specific things that human rights organizations and the human rights community can do to support the work of sex worker rights defenders? And specifically, how can non-sex worker-led organizations help advance the work of sex worker rights defenders? So anybody who wants to jump in on that one, it would be great to hear.
I can say something maybe, especially because it speaks to allyship, and how do we ensure that we are inclusive in how we think about things. And as a medical doctor, I'm particularly frustrated, right, with the global health and how everything is so siloed. So when often people speak about sex work decrim, they'll be speaking about it in terms of HIV. And often we say, it's not just about HIV. It's also about other pleasurable experiences. It's about the right to self-determine. It's about the right to have safer sex tools, which are important to the occupation, right? And what we often call the tools of trade. And so often a lot of funding that comes from global funders and other states is that they have an anti-sex work clause in it, which makes it really hard for institutions, organizations, and individuals to organize in their own countries if they're recipients of particular aid, you know? And that's what the problem is. And that's why it's a structural systemic issue. And we have to relook at the entire way that global health is funded. Because for me, the same person who's a sex worker today that we want to have information about their own health and well-being could be the same person who may require a safe abortion service. It's the same person who may require, you know, updates in terms of their identity documents and travel documents. This is the same person who may require safety and security in the workplace, because we know, for example, transphobia and homophobia is still something that's very entrenched even in corporate world. So it's about moving away from the siloed approach and really being clear that in every single organization, in every single program, in every single advocacy that we do, we have to be intersectional about it. Otherwise, we will continue to leave people behind, even within the movements of human rights defenders. And I know for a fact that a lot of it does get impacted by the funders who set the agenda, who set the programs, who set the indicators and priorities. And that becomes really, really difficult. And you find that the civil society then becomes fractured as a result of funders and philanthropists who set the agenda on people's behalf. Thank you.
I want to underline something you said really quickly before jumping to other folks, which is the funding restrictions, which are so important to emphasize. You know, just to be super specific about them, this is something I've reported on for a long time. This was one of the very first things that international sex worker activists put on my radar more than 10 years ago, which is that, you know, it's baked into U.S. foreign aid funding to restrict funds from USAID programs to organizations who adopt an explicit policy opposing not just the practice of, but also the legalization of, in their language, of sex work. And what that has meant is that sex worker rights defense work has been interrupted. Groups who were creating drop-in centers, who were creating education programs, childcare programs, and health programs, you know, had to face this impossible choice. Do I say no to this funding, or do I take this funding and stop doing work in sex worker community? And that is still part of the law in the United States. It's on folks in the US to put some pressure on our elected officials to change that. I don't know if the Biden administration has taken a stance on it. And one of the leaders on this in Congress is US Representative Barbara Lee, who's an incredible advocate for sex worker rights as well, one of the very few. So if that's new information for folks, I encourage you to learn some more about the US anti-prostitution pledge and the impact that that has on sex worker rights defense globally. I'm gonna open this up again for other folks who wanna answer this question about, you know, how sex worker groups advance the work of sex worker rights defenders.
Note Andrew appears to be giving me some space, so I will take it briefly and then I would love to hear from him as well. I think that drawing from some of our own learnings on this, there are many, many ways to approach this topic and to be a supportive ally. We found ours in this HRD protection line. So everything that we say, everything that right, it always comes back to this idea of sex workers who are human rights defenders, the work that they do, the risks that they face, and the protection needs that they have. So for other human rights organizations who have joined us today, if that framework, take the report, translate the report, use our infographics, do what you can with it, write it to you, then take it. If that framing doesn't quite fit for you, there are other framings to be had. As Dr. T was saying, she comes at this from a health perspective, right? Others might be coming from a transgender rights perspective. There's housing justice, there's bodily autonomy. There are many angles to be a good ally, even if some of the other angles don't sit quite right with you. That would be a first piece of advice, but then there's much more practical things. So inviting sex worker rights defenders to give talks at your organizations, to learn from them so that when you encounter these issues, you have some personal experience to draw on, and you have learnings from defenders, and you have firsthand knowledge of what defenders are going through. And then even more sort of practically, where security permits, if you are in a location where it is not safe for sex worker rights defenders to gather, even before COVID, offer physical spaces for human rights defenders to come together for meetings, for community buildings, for training. When your identity is criminalized, particularly for defenders who have a physical appearance that is stereotypically associated with sex work, so transgender human rights defenders, particularly Black transgender human rights defenders in some places, where their physical appearance increases the risk that if they gather together, they will be thought to be either selling sex or promoting prostitution, as in the case that Andrew talked about, offering safe space can mean the difference between gathering privately or gathering publicly and then being arrested as a result. I would say learning from defenders themselves and then looking into what are the practical things that you could do today to fill some of those protection gaps for defenders.
Thanks, Erin. I mean, if I was to add a couple of new things, I would say one of the really good things in terms of our journey as frontline defenders was the way that Erin and other colleagues managed some of the discussions in a way that enabled people to ask difficult questions and be quite frank about this is a difficult issue for a lot of people. People come to it with lots of emotional or other perceptions about how this fits in with other aspects of their human rights activism. And I think it's important to try and have a safe space to have some discussion of those discussions. And the other part of it is about, you know, who makes the biggest difference in terms of advancing human rights? It's those who are working at the local and national level. It's our mantra in terms of all kinds of human rights defenders, but it's particularly true with sex workers' rights defenders. And if you're working on issues that touch on sex workers or in this kind of intersectional way in which different discriminations and human rights violations pile up across different things, including housing and access to healthcare, etc., then you've got to listen to sex worker rights defenders, those who speak from within the community, who have the expertise, who have the agency, who have been working on these issues, and you have to treat those people with dignity, invite them into your spaces, learn from them, look at what you can benefit from the wisdom that they will bring to your efforts to try and advance the human rights issues that you're working on.
Thank you for that. Does anyone else want to jump in and answer that question? We're just about at time, but I just wanted to give us a moment if Katie or Cayenne wanted to add anything on this question of what groups that aren't led by sex workers can do to support the work of sex worker human rights defenders.
I think it should be good when we are talking about their human right, they have, as we already know, that they have not about their citizen and also their skin or ways that you are class. So that can be also help for the sex worker organization and human rights sex worker right defender to make sure that with the support of their partner and allies to be effectively and working at the different level for the sex worker and their right defender. But what currently, in according to my experience, what I'm currently seeing, a lot of people are supporting from the behind. But when the sex worker human right defender face the problem, they have very, very real support. Very few support from the people examined and NGO or other people who are working for the in the civil society organization. So I think when we want to support to the sex worker right defender, or we want to support to the sex worker, we have to be all becoming to the same place. It's not about in the way you are sitting on your position. That will help us to be achieve more and also impact to the community and also in the advocacy level. This is one of the things. Another thing is also that also always sex worker led organization are less accessing the funding or the resource from the donor there because of the lack of legal document or the lack of required donor requirement. So it does not support to the sex worker-led organization and sex worker community to do the way of they want to do and what they think the priority for them, what they can be working on impact. So then the third issue is also that we do have to work on the different area. Like example for the trafficking, I don't want to touch for the trafficking, but there have also the many trafficking are happening in the around the world. Why people, the anti-trafficking group only attack to the sex worker as their target group. That's have to be, we need to get support from the other non-sex worker organization who work on the human rights issue. That will help us to be the reduce the trafficking and also to prevent the many other factors that does is around the sex worker. I think that's, I just want to give them some of the input. Yeah.
I think that's a great place actually to close this. I'm so appreciative of everybody who joined us, who stayed with us. If you missed anything or if you want to share this with anyone after, you can also go check out the Frontline Defenders YouTube page or Facebook page. A recording of this is going to go online shortly after we finish. Also, if folks didn't get to see Ismail's video, his testimony that was filmed in Tanzania is featured in the interactive report. So if you would like to see more about the work that he's doing and what's happening for sex worker rights defenders in Tanzania, you can go to the Frontline Defenders website and check out the report there. I want to just congratulate everybody who took part in making this happen. This report, like I said at the top, is a very long time coming, recognizing work that sex worker rights defenders have been doing for decades. Even when it hasn't been officially recognized as human rights defense work, the work goes on. And I really just hope that this is a moment when even more resources can come to that work, and even more folks, including folks who aren't part of sex worker organizations explicitly, can step in and find ways to amplify the work that is already happening, can find ways to move resources to the work that's already happening. That could be as simple even as opening up meeting space, as folks have said. The stakes are very high, and I wouldn't take for granted that sex worker rights are going to be on the radar of an organization just because they care about public health, they care about human rights work, they care about women's rights. So you might be the one person in your organization who sees that and wants to make that happen. That's incredibly important, and the resources that you might need to make that happen are right here in this community. So I encourage you to share the report. Go check out the story on the Guardian's website as well. That's an easier format to share with folks, and of course share the videos that we showed today. So with that, thanks everyone. See you on the internet, and thanks. Take care.